The only person I think who, apart from James, who gets more excited than myself about wild dogs is, of course... Oh, dearie me, a little bit of a signal dip. Right, what I was going to say is the only person who gets more excited than I do about wild dogs is, of course, the inimitable Brent Leo Smith, who will be like a dog with a bone now that he has fresh wild dog tracks. Let's go and find out where he is.
Good morning and welcome to Safari Live. Isn't this exciting? I'm just stopped here. I'm trying to listen. I heard a Franklin sounding a little bit upset, and I'm half hoping to see a puppy appear. So I'm Brent. I've got Dangerous Dave, the objectified dish, on the back with me today. And we're hoping for some wild dogs. Now, those of you who keep an eye on the Juma Dam cam, they could easily pop up there for a drink. So their tracks basically head straight towards us, opposite where we are, but with wild dogs, they can change direction like that as soon as they see something. So let's keep moving. I'm just going to do a little loop down Rebecca's Road here, and then if I get nothing by the corner, I'm going to head back to Quarantine. They like coming through this block to the western edge of Quarantine. And remember, keep an eye out on the Juma Dam cam. And also remember, we're on a live safari, and you can ask us questions by popping us an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Come on, puppies, those impala look far too relaxed. Now, impala, alarm call, as we've seen many times, for lion and leopard, they'll snort at them, even walk towards them once they've been spotted. With the African wild dog, they don't. They just disappear. They just start running in every direction to try to avoid those very successful predators. I'm going to go a little bit further, but if I think the impala are looking that relaxed, then they might not have passed through here, because even the whiff of a wild dog is enough to send an impala scattering. Now, wild dogs, you can also smell them once they've passed. It's a very distinct sort of musty, wet dog / old cupboard odor. Haven't got a whiff just yet. Okay, so just checking carefully here. Herbie found the tracks up ahead somewhere, heading into this block. I'm just trying to decide where I'm going to go next. I haven't seen any tracks, so they've gone into this. It's quite a large area without any roads. So I think what I might do is go down to our southern boundary and then work my way back towards this area. Quite a big vista from here, so I'm trying to check into the block, see if I spot that movement of a dog dashing through the mixed broad-leaved woodland that predominates the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. Now, every now and then I'm going to turn off if they are hunting and they get separated. They use a wonderful call called a woo call. Not a woo girl, and we don't get any of those out in the bush, although apparently there were a few around last night. But we get a woo. There we go. Standing by. We get woo calls. Okay, so Herbie says he's just behind me. Oh, listen, I'm listening for that woo call, which is goes, woo, woo, woo. Come on, call back, guys. No, very unlikely. My woo call is probably not nearly good enough to attract a dog. Just going to chat to Herbie quickly. Herb from the junction, Ballinati says, confirms straight due south, so sort of towards Treehouse Dam in the block. Copy. Okay, so we're just trying to figure out the plan. And while we figure out the plan, Jamie's going to show you exactly what a wild dog track looks like.
Now the tracks are...
We're sitting here at the junction with Herbert, who has just pointed out where he found the tracks. Right next to where we were going to go and search for Shadow, as it happens. All right, we're going to hop out and we're going to try. Unfortunately, the light's not fantastic. Oh, goodness. Speenie doesn't want to stay on my head. That's not fantastic, but we're going to try and show you what a wild dog track looks like. Herbert has very kindly circled them already for us. Oh, and I'm going to try and just lift that up. So the stick's fallen on top of them, but the track is here, and it looks very, very similar to a hyena track, except much smaller. So it's got the two lobes at the back of the pad. I'm going to draw it for you, because it's difficult to see. Here is a toe, here is a toe, here is a toe, here is a toe. And the one thing that you see really, really clearly in wild dog tracks, claws. One, two, three, and four. Little dots in the sand, because they have got quite prominent claws. It's not easy to see in this light. Here is another track. They don't have the crosswalk that the hyenas do. In other words, their feet fall straight. They don't fall at an angle. With a hyena, your foot goes off at a right angle, and then the back foot kind of, they walk like, what's this called? Kind of like a duck, with their feet slightly turned out to their body. Wild dogs do not do that. Little dots of toes. Herbert thinks there's three. I'm impressed he can tell that, because the tracks just go everywhere, as do wild dogs. Question is, did I miss tracks on Philemon's cut line? If I did, Brent is never going to let me down. Live it down. Let's go check. Oh, Speedy's not working out for me. Sorry, everybody. I know it's noisy because that's where my microphone sits. But for some reason, Kirsty's beanie really doesn't want to stay on my head today. Here we go. All right. Let us go, I guess. But where to? Going to be listening to Brent and Herbert on the Game Drive channel as well. Try and coordinate a plan of attack. Herbert says these tracks are very fresh, which makes sense because they certainly weren't here yesterday as we drove home in the evening. Whoa. Everybody hold on. Things might get a little bit bumpy. Right. Let's go. We're going to take the same route that we're going to go back along the road that Brent took. There's no harm in that because the dogs crisscross so much that it increases our chances of actually finding them. And Shelly, absolutely. I'm so excited to see Wild Dog. It's been months since I last saw them. I know James had a sighting recently on Juma. I have been waiting ages, patiently, sort of patiently, almost patiently, for us to find wild dogs once again. And of course, the best part of it will be round September, I would say, or so, that we get to the part of the wild dog breeding season where we might actually even see the pups when they come out. And one day we're going to have a live safari where we've got wild dogs denning. And that is something incredible to look forward to. I have never seen a newly born wild dog puppy, but it is something that would, I'm sure, melt the heart of the hardest person. And I can't wait for some of you, it might even be your first time encountering wild dogs. We've got some kudu staring at us out of the bushes. They also look relatively relaxed. They don't look as though they've just encountered a pack of wild dogs, but perhaps three is not too much of a threat to them. They all look pretty calm, cantering through the bushes, but only really, it's sort of half-hearted, that race towards each other. It's just away from the big male that's walking at the back. Now, we spoke a lot about this yesterday, about the fact that you can gauge plenty of what's going on around you from the animal's behavior. They don't look nervous, although I think they might just have picked up the smell of wild dogs. Staying huddled together. But stopping to feed. No, I don't think that they are too concerned. Stop it. Yeah, okay. Let's carry on. See if we can't figure out where these wild dogs have gone. And it's interesting, their tracks immediately cut into the block. Let us see, let us see. You can see Brent on the other side of this patch of vegetation on the road called Philemon's Cutline. Oh, and one enormous waterbuck bull. Oh, hello, boy. You are mighty handsome. There are lots and lots of general game around. Usually when wild dogs come sprinting through an area, you often find it becomes completely deserted. But here we've got a magnificent waterbuck bull. Looking back into the block. Now, again, a pack of three probably wouldn't target a waterbuck of that size. Wouldn't really be worth the risk. However, if there were more dogs, and the sands pack at its original, or the first time I ever saw it, numbered 21 individuals a couple of months ago. I'm uncertain as now, at this point, in terms of puppies and so on, what the final count is for the Sabi sand pack. But it would be very interesting to know. But a group of 21, and it can go right up to 30, even up to 40 dogs in certain packs. And then what happens from there is very often you get breakaways from the wild dog pack itself moving off. And what that means is whilst we have two wild dog packs that we are very, very familiar with, the Investec and the Sabi Sand Pack, what that does mean is that occasionally we encounter what are known as dispersal packs. Rebecca is a little bit concerned that I can't hear her. I absolutely can. Sorry, Rebecca, I'm concentrating on the The search for the wild dogs, I do hear you. All is well. Fresh wild dog tracks and yet no wild dogs. They seem to melt into the bush, particularly when there's only three of them. I think if we don't come up with any luck here, I'm going to take a chance and head a little bit further west. There might be a chance that they're heading back towards the den site. But let's just do one more loop. And then we'll expand the search outwards ever so slightly. Luckily for us, you know, there's impala here. I'm not going to stop for them right now, but they're far too relaxed. Now, generally, this is the one animal that impala don't even, the one predator that impala don't even think about alarm calling for. They don't even waste their breath. They just run. When they see wild dogs coming, they sprint away. They don't even bother trying to warn the others, and that's because wild dogs have the speed and stamina to chase them down. So they're not standing to wait for them to see what they do. They know at any time they could become targets, and they just want to leave the area as quickly as possible. While we do this loop, and at some point I think we might even encounter Brent on the road, but while we do this loop, let's head back onto his vehicle, find out how he's doing.
Good news and bad news, and the good news and the bad news is exactly the same thing. We have no tracks coming out here, but that's also good news because... Oh, they just crossed behind us. Oh! So they must have just run straight behind us because we just checked that area very carefully. So, let's see, they are going south. Jamie, it looked like they crossed behind me, Weaver's Nest Junction, Philemon's. Just checked that area on foot as well. Sorry about that, we need to try and stay coordinated in the hunt for the African wild dog, one of the fastest moving predators. So even though they don't have the highest top speed, their top speed can be continued for a long time. Okay, what we're gonna do is we're gonna go, there we go, there's Jamie. So she's going to check up that side. I'm going to go here and then I'm going to go down to Twin Dams to make sure they don't go through. So as you can see, hunting wild dogs is not a sedate thing. If you find them sleeping, that's great, but they are the most active of our predators. Now keep your eyes open, Dangerous Dave. The objectified dish. Somehow I don't think Dangerous Dave minds being objectified. There's very relaxed impala, so they could have passed through here quite a bit earlier. Or they've cut through towards Treehouse Dam. I haven't got that distinct wild dog whiff yet. Morning, Gail. Gail's wondering whether wild dogs are territorial like lions and leopards. They are. So a pack will have an alpha male, alpha female, and the rest of the pack will stay with them and help them raise their young. So normally only the alpha pair will breed, but sometimes a beta female will breed as well. In certain circumstances, the alpha female will let those puppies live in some circumstances, she'll actually kill those puppies. And they have quite a large home range, about 60,000 hectares, so about just under 130,000 acres. And okay, heavy's gone that way, so let's just check carefully through here. Now we're hoping to not see tracks. We're actually hoping to see the animals. We are getting quite close to the southern edge of our traverse area. I see some water buck in the distance. They're very relaxed. That's not a good sign. I got a feeling the wild dogs might have gone through here while we were still sleeping, or actually while we were having coffee. Lots of relaxed kudu. Now, Michael likes to know, are wild dogs, elephants causing a bit of a problem here. Are wild dogs active at night, or do they sleep during the night? So, Michael, they're mostly crepuscular. So most active at dusk and dawn. But on well-lit moon nights, they will quite often hunt through into the night. They do move at night, but they don't really hunt. Now, they are try to move less at night to avoid lions and leopards, or more lions than anything else. Now, lions pose the biggest threat to the African wild dog. And most wild dog mortalities are due to lions. Still. Thought I got a little whiff of wild dog there. No, I got a whiff of water buck. I've got a sneaky suspicion that they might have already skedaddled out of our traverse area. But positive thoughts. Hold on. Whoop-a. Now, Molly's wondering whether these dogs will be vaccinated. Of course, dogs are an endangered species, the second most endangered canid in Africa. Only about 4,500 left in the wild. And the Sabi Sands has already got a vaccination project underway. We probably won't collar the dogs, or not all the dogs, all the packs, but we definitely vaccinate. Now we made it all the way to the southern boundary. Okay. Now we're hoping not to find tracks here. Checking very carefully. Now, I see a vehicle way down the road there that looks like it's might be looking at something, so I'm just going to be on the radio. Okay, I'm just checking very carefully. Very, very slowly. Morning stations in the east. Have you guys had any updates on my Dutch this morning? Standing by. Copy. Our last tracks we had sort of opposite Lucas open, still heading straight south. We haven't managed to locate yet. I'm just seeing if anyone saw any tracks on Gowrie Main. Copy, thanks. So no tracks crossing yet. So I'm just listening to the radio. We're trying to coordinate our movements. So we've checked now way down the southern boundary. There's Jamie. Now with wild dogs, they can change their direction at any time. Where are you off to next?
I think I'm going to go
Shabam. Okay, I haven't done Shabam. I've only just come off Treehouse on it. So I haven't done the rest of Shabam. I think I'll do Elephant Carcass.
Yes, okay. I'm going to take
you to a dance. Okay, cool. All right, bye. Bye. And across to you, by the way.
Okay.
Bye.
And back across to us. And so we race along. Very much excitement. All of the excitement. Darby from Elephant Plains is driving the southern boundary as well, hoping, contrary to us, that they're going to come this way. Because then, of course, he gets to view them. We don't want them to go that way, because then we don't. But the wild dogs being wild dogs, they're going to do their thing regardless. Okay, this boundary's been checked relatively thoroughly. I think if we've missed them crossing, then we all need to go back to training school. If four professional guides have missed them crossing the road in front of us, then we've definitely got a problem. Come on, dogs. Where are you hiding? Taxon, in his sort of laconic kind of way, has said that perhaps they are in Mala Mala by now. Which is a valid point. They do eat up the distance, but you never know. I'm really hoping that's not the case. Mala Mala is quite far from here, just by the way. And Jess, watching on YouTube, Jess has said that perhaps it's time to invest in a bubble wrap suit for these moments of chaos where we go racing after wild dogs. Jess, I imagine that the cameramen feel much the same. This, of course, I think is... Gert, is this your first wild dog chase with us?
Yes, it is.
It is your first one. Okay, so Gert is getting to experience this for the first time. So far, we've been relatively tame. We haven't gone off-road yet. Although, I have to confess, I have this sneaking suspicion if I push Wendy too hard, her wheel might fall off. So we're going to be a bit more gentle with Wendy than we might otherwise be. But Jess is absolutely right, and if you've ever missed these wild dog moments, or if you've never seen a wild dog moment like this before, you'll experience something incredible while you watch. We've just got to find them. Come on, dogs. I love these wild dog mornings. You forget about the cold, you forget about everything. There's lion tracks, so we can't forget about that. I've got to take note of that. These are from yesterday. Never mind. He crossed straight out of the property, by the way. Herbert did track him. This is the one we were tracking yesterday morning. I remember now. Oh, sorry, Chad. Chad says if it suddenly goes silent in the back, that I must just drive back and fetch him. Because it means I've thrown him out. Which I don't want to do. Tracks. No tracks. Just hyena tracks. That's the wonderful thing about wild dog chases in the morning. As I said, you forget about the cold, but also your brain is working at as fast as it can possibly go because there's paw prints in the dirt. And these paw prints can be so deceptive because you're racing past and they do, at first glance, really look like a hyena track and vice versa. So, for example, these tracks that I've just found now are not wild dog, they're hyena, but they have caused me a moment's delay. And of course, the other option as to what is happening is that they've killed something. With their enormously high success rate, they're... It smells something, but it smells more like waterbuck than it does wild dog, but you never know. I think Brent described the scent of them to you. There's a distinct wet doggy smell, dirty wet dog, and they really are. They're quite filthy creatures. They're wonderful. But every time they find a fresh buffalo pat or a pile of hyena scat, nothing brings them greater joy than to throw themselves upon it with wild abandon and roll in it, leaving them with a very distinctive edge to their odor. I love it. It brings happy memories. And Yankees girl, to say that I could tell where they've gone by smell, I won't lay that claim. I cannot track by smell alone. The difference in animal smell, it's as different as different perfumes to us or anything like that. There's different animals have really, really distinctive smells. It's the waterbuck have a musky goat smell, as described by James. He's far better at describing smells than I am. He describes it as goat. An elephant has a grassy smell, buffalo cattle smell, and wild dogs, dirty dog. Hyenas also have their own unique scent. It's like the animal perfumes of the bush. Very, very different for each individual species. But I don't lay claim at all to being able to track them by a sense of smell. I really don't. It just helps to say, okay, they've been here. I'm getting caught out by hyena tracks today. I don't really want to miss any tracks because I'm going to get shouted at by Herbert, who doesn't suffer such things lightly. And welcome to Michael. I spoke before about the prospect of one day having a hyena den on our... No, sorry, not hyena den, a wild dog den on our live safaris, and how incredibly exciting that would be. Now, Mike would like to know if the wild dogs den like hyenas do, or do they hide the pups in thick cover in the way that lions do? And the answer is they have a den very similar to a hyena. They take over old termite mounds where they hide their pups. So in this area in particular, because there's no real rocky crevices or anything like that, they will all move into a termite mound that has been excavated by something like an aardvark, maybe inhabited by a warthog at some point, and they will then move in, and that's where they will live. Whew. Okay. And the most amazing part of this whole thing is that if this is part of the sands pack, they are heading out to find food not just for themselves, but for the pups as well. And Felicity, yes, absolutely. The wild dogs that do not breed provide food and care for the pups as if they were their own. It is such a special, really amazing society or pack grouping that a wild dog has. And what they do is only the male and the female, the alpha male and the alpha female breed. Sometimes things happen and a slightly lower ranking female will fall pregnant. Her pups seldom survive, but sometimes they do. But the whole pack is dedicated to looking after the alpha female's puppies. And they may well be siblings, they might even not be siblings. And what they will do is they will babysit them, they will guard them, they will bring back food and regurgitate it. So instead of dragging a carcass in the way that a hyena does, the wild dogs gobble up all they can, they get to the entrance of the den, and the pups solicit food by begging, making little begging sounds, and the adults then regurgitate. They basically vomit up the food, and the pups wolf it down. And they'll do the same for the babysitter. And there's even been recorded cases of wild dogs that have lost limbs, that obviously can't keep up with the rest of the pack, that will have, or that will survive long before they might have otherwise, because the pack has cared for them. I even heard of a case of a wild dog that lost two limbs, and it stayed alive for ages because the wild dogs cared for it. They kept regurgitating food for it. How amazing is that? It's time just to calm down a little bit and sort of change the tempo from manic to frantic and just stop and listen for a second. It might just pay off. We're at Treehouse Dam. They love this spot. Or they did, anyway, when there was water in it. There's no longer water. It's completely dry, as you can see. The question is, where have these dogs gone? I don't even hear a sound. And we haven't picked up any tracks, but with us, with lots of vehicles racing around, it's entirely possible that we've missed something. Hoping to hear that contact call. Whoop. Whoop. Well, I better not do that too loudly, or else Brent, with his extraordinary hearing, will come running. Okay, the wild dogs have gone east. We're searching in the wrong place. Into the rising sun we go. And we shall take pangolin track. So they've gone east rather than south, keeping us guessing as they always do. Keep an eye out on the Juma Dam camera. That's the message for final control, by the way. Because there is a chance that they could pop out somewhere there. Hello to Trent watching in Fiji. That's awesome to hear. Now, Trent was wondering about the wild dog hunting success rate. Does that refer to individual encounters or overall hunting attempts as a whole? There's a little bit of scientific confusion here, because a lot of the success rate might not be as successful as they are thought to be. Just because the success rate is sort of calculated on how many kills they make in a day, but We don't always know, it's very difficult to monitor exactly how many kills they initiate, or at least how many hunts they initiate versus the kill percentage that they make. That is the typical standard way of calculating success rate. So it's number of kills made divided by number of attempts, and that will give you the percentage. The thing about wild dogs is just their sheer persistence. They flush, they course through the bush and they flush things out. So it's not even, I don't know where you define a hunting attempt, because it's not like a stalk. It's very easy to look at a lion stalking and say, okay, that hunt has been initiated. That's boom, that's where the hunt starts. With wild dogs, it's that constant manic motion. And as soon as they see something, they go for it. But it's not really a hunt initiated. It's a difficult thing. And what they'll often do is it's just they flushed something. They'll run after it for a little bit and then they'll go, actually, no, we don't have a chance of catching that. Moving on. It's an incredible thing for us to witness. Now, for us, it's really, really difficult unless they are in an open area to witness them kill something. It has happened before. It happened with Hayden at one of the dams where the wild dogs managed to corner an impala in the dam itself and eventually managed to catch her. But beyond kills, it is just such a pleasure to see them move. They're like poetry in motion when we do find them. Those rippling, athletic bodies of theirs, they really are just magic. And I haven't seen them in so long, I'm desperate for this chase to result in a sighting. I wonder if we shouldn't go further afield. I know that Brent had already moved a little bit further to the east. Now let's jump on the back of his vehicle and find out what his plans are from there.
Welcome back, guys. Sorry, I'm still concentrating on tracks at the moment. And it looks like I've got tracks going straight to the Juma Dam cam. Carefully around here. Now there might have been impala or something that could have set them off in any direction. I don't have tracks anymore. Last track I had was just back there. Check back up onto quarantine. Maybe they chased something onto quarantine. Herbs, looks, Nkonza and Twin Dams quite close to Vuyatela Dam. I've lost the Nkonza. It looks like I might head back west towards quarantine. I'm going to check quarantine quickly. AFM. Come on, puppies. Copy, thanks. Now, Michael Fleetwood's wondering why we use the Shangaan word mahloa on the radio rather than the word wild dog. It's because some of the lodges don't have earpieces like we do. Now, there were lots of impala here this morning. Now, there are none. Always a good sign that dogs have been through the area. And sorry, Michael, I'm just really concentrating on them. They move so quickly, I want to make sure we spot them. I just want to listen for a second, and then I've also spotted something else. You see it there, Dave? Well done. It's a lone wildebeest, miles and miles away. Sorry, Michael. Some of the game drives do not vehicles do not have earpieces like we do. So what happens is if you shout wild dog over the radio, all their guests hear it, and they could be 25 kilometers away. And then all the guests want to rush to wild dogs. And as you can see, tracking wild dogs is not the easiest thing in the world because they are so mobile. I'm gonna skirt quarantine. Now, I'm not seeing a living soul in quarantine at the moment, and there were quite a few in Palo when we started, especially on that southern corner. Let's just head back down there. Again, I'm going to switch off in a second to listen. Now, if they've made a call, we'll hear a high-pitched tittering call of excitement. Oh, they move so fast. Living soul on quarantine, which is a good sign. The dogs might have passed through here. Just want to see where all those impala were earlier this morning, and they were right here. I just want to listen for a second. Keeping quiet and listening. Well, can't hear anything just yet. Now, hi, John Birchall, and a big Safari Live welcome. And John is a new viewer. Wouldn't it be great to see wild dogs? John said this is fantastic. Well, John, hopefully for your first time on Safari Live, we might be able to produce you some wild dogs. Now, I'm going to go back to last tracks and see if I can discern what's happening around there. Jamie is jumping ahead, checking around Galago Pan. So if they chase something and they didn't drink at the Juma Pan, they might have headed across to drink at the Galago Pan. Chat to Herbie quickly. Herbie. Herb, last encounter is just to the south of Vuyatela Pan on Twin Dams Road. I've checked quarantine. There's Lutumala or anything there, but I can't see any encounter. Maybe come check this last encounter on Twin Dams. Okay, so while we go to the last track and try to figure out exactly what's going on, let's jump on board with Jamie.
Now, while Brent heads to the last tracks that he saw, I'm taking a shot in the dark here, and we've come a little bit further north, kind of working on the assumption that somehow the wild dogs managed to duck the dam camera and get across to the other side and perhaps But what is here?
So I'm just trying to check exactly where that wild dog dashed off the road. Can you hear a hyena in the distance? But it's not an excited, I'm stealing a kill from a wild dog call. It's just a normal sort of contact call.
Losing your audio.
Okay. So the tracks were around here somewhere. What I'm going to do is Herbie's on his way. I'm going to let Herbie figure this out. I'm going to go check a little bit further to the east. Okay, I'm just going to wait for Herbie to get you. It seems like we've got Jamie again, so let's go see what she's up to.
Oopsie daisy, well it appears as though we disappeared off your screen there.
Quang, what you quang about? Quang.
It'd be very funny if we came racing around the corner and we bumped into a leopard or something. Not bumped, literally. But if we found a leopard. Because look at these. Look at this go-away bird in the tree. Can you see it there, Gav? In the knob thorn there. Looking very cross. What's wrong? But that being said, I think that the go-away birds around the Galago Pan are particularly angry. They're always shouting at something. What are you seeing? They do appear to be looking downwards. Let's just go back towards the road. What have you found? Oh, maybe not. There's a question that John has asked while we watch the go-away bird's alarm call, which is, why would birds alarm call for predators that pose no threat to them? I often ask myself that question. Because you are absolutely correct. Why does a go-away bird alarm call at a lion? The chances of a lion catching a go-away bird, next to nothing. So what is it? What atavistic instinct is it within them that tells them, oh, that's what they're alarm calling at? Oh, my goodness. Oh, sorry, Gert, straight into the sun. I knew they were angry about something. It's not what we thought it was. It is a bird of prey, in this case, what looks like a harrier hawk. Yesterday we had this extraordinary sighting with a harrier hawk that pulled a snake out of a tree. Okay, that's why they sound so cross. Well, in this case, John, not alarm calling without reason, because, of course, this is a threat to them. Okay, I'm going to help things out here by repositioning, because this is a really tricky shot, straight into the sun, and at a really awkward angle for poor Gert. Whoopsie. That was entirely my fault, putting him there. Oh, that sun's so bright. Oh, there's two. There's two. There we go. I think that's actually a better view. We've got two of them here. How awesome is that? No wonder the birds are so upset. I will go a little bit. Oh, I'm positively blind. I've been staring at this into the sun and I can't see at all. My eyes are full of spots. Oh, no wonder our birds are so upset and always, as always, first into the fray are the drongos. There's a little drongo off to the right. Just listen for a moment to the sounds around us. Well, everything absolutely furious. Oh, so angry. There he goes. Here comes the other one to join up. They are gymnogenes or harrier hawks, so professional bird nest raiders by trade. Awesome. Oh, into the sun. Magic. And there goes number two, following behind. Well done, Gert. That's absolutely epic. There goes number two. They've decided they've had enough of the furious birds surrounding them. They've had it, they're gone. Okay, let's go onto Mvubu Road. I've just had an update that the wild dogs are coming this way. So well, that was a marvelous sighting. Unfortunately, it's a temporary sight. Well, it's a sighting that's over. Our stations, I'm on Mvubu Road now. I'll carry on north rather than checking the Galago Pan. Okay, tracks are heading in that direction. That was such an awesome sighting because it gives you an idea of just how cross every single bird gets when a harrier hawk is in the area, because with their double jointed legs, they raid nests. And it makes sense for each and every bird to band together and try to chase them away. And I could hear in that collection the hornbills were alarm calling, the go away birds, the drongos, and that click whistle, puffback shrike, also there. A puffback shrike or a, what's the old name again? It's. I can't remember. Sorry guys, I'm so distracted by everything that's going on around here. The wild dogs are apparently heading straight in this direction. We should even potentially go and check the old hyena den, see if they don't pop out around there. But really interesting questions coming through about alarm calls. John, I think there might be a time at which perhaps they don't distinguish, the birds don't distinguish between the potential predation of, say, by a caracal or a serval, which they definitely are a threat to them, versus a leopard or a lion, but I'm not 100% convinced on that argument. I really do see your point. Perhaps it stems back to an old evolutionary drive. I've got their tracks here. Where are they? I can even smell them. I've just picked up on their tracks going north on Mvubu Road. They're here somewhere, guys. Let me just double check this, make sure I'm not going crazy. I'm not going crazy. It's wild dogs, and they're here, I can smell them. This is where your sense of smell comes in so handy, because you can smell them and you start to know that these tracks that you're looking at are fresh. Here's a zebra. Zebra doesn't look unhappy. The tracks are still on the road. Not a good direction for those tracks to be going in, because north of us is the boundary. No, don't go into Bubblesook, please. Tracks still on the road. Still beautifully fresh. Come on, dogs. Still on the road. Remember how I said in this block they often use the road because it's so dense around them that it's quite an easy way of traveling. Their tracks have gone off the road, as I said that. No, they're still here. Oh, I can smell them. You smell that?
Yep.
I smell them. Oh no, we're right on the boundary. Come on, dogs. Incredible smell. Oh, not good. We've just missed them. We've just missed them. I think they've gone across into Buffelzook. Their tracks have gone off the road, but they were heading straight in this direction. And we must have been moments behind them. Up and down, up and down. And straight into Buffelzook, I think. Let me just double check that. Let's make sure they're not running on the cut line, because we might still find them if they are. I almost want to hop out, but Brent's on his way, so he'll be able to help me spot. I think they've crossed. I don't see them crossed though. I don't see where they popped out. Ooh, Brent and I are about to have a car accident. That would be disastrous. It's a bit of a tricky spot here. It's a bit of a tricky spot. Check there in that corner. I think they've gone. I can't see where they've crossed here though. So they might be on the cut line still. I don't know if you see any tracks coming through. But I can smell them. I can smell them on a Booba road.
What do you want to do?
Move out of your way probably is a good start. Don't put oneself. One should never put oneself between Brent Leo Smith and wild dogs. Let's go forward a little bit. No, their tracks are still here. Yeah, definitely. You go.
Okay.
Cool. Go ahead. Bye. The tracks are still on the road. We've still got a chance. I'm letting Brent go ahead because he's got Rusty. Rusty has signal at Sydney Dam. Oh, no. Not again, Gert. A life lesson for us all. Never put oneself behind Brent Leo Smith on his way to a wild dog sighting either. Here we go, guys. Let me show you their tracks. While I let Brent's dust settle. There you go. As they race fresh tracks on the cut line going west towards Sydney's Dam. So they still haven't gone north. They're here. Aren't they beautiful? Look at them all the way up along the road. Absolutely stunning. Almost as good as having a wild dog itself. There's something lovely about a fresh track first thing in the morning. On a road, beautifully clear, and it's just like, you can picture, can't you just picture them in that trotting way that they do going down the road? My beanie's about to fall off. I don't blame it after all of that chaos, though. Whew. Sorry, I need to sneeze. Stuck again. Brr. Okay, I think the dust has settled enough for us to continue on our way, slightly more sedately, because unfortunately we don't have signal in that area. Standing by. Copy. All right, Brent's no longer got tracks on the road. He would like us to check really, really carefully whether they've gone. Brent is all the way over there already, moving at the speed of light. We are going to check really carefully that they didn't go in north. We want them to go south. That's where we want them to go. It's so unpredictable in their movements. They're probably going to go straight back towards the den site now. Come on, wild dogs. No, they've already crossed off. Let me just double check that. Oh no, they haven't. Sorry guys, I'm checking really, really carefully. James, can wild dogs den in an old hyena den? Yes, potentially. They might. It doesn't often happen though, because they don't really want to risk the hyenas deciding to move back in to the den site itself. So they don't always, they don't often move into a den site that has previously been occupied by a hyena, which makes sense. Because imagine you've got your wild dog pups and then one day, lo and behold, an entire hyena clan rocks up and says, and wants their den site back. You're going to have some, well done. You're going to have some majorly upset. What's wrong, Impala? Oh, you're a confused male, aren't you? Don't do that to my heart rate. I got very excited there. But it's just a male and his hormones, by the looks of things. I said that Impala don't alarm call at wild dogs, and they generally don't. But you can't really afford to ignore the sights and sounds of the bush. But he's just an Impala ram that's got confused. With his harem of ladies. Why do they all look so relaxed? They must have just come into this area because there's no way that they would be looking this relaxed if the wild dogs hadn't just come through. Or had just come through. Well, maybe there's a little bit of alertness to their body language. And the sun's just disappeared, which makes tracking wild dogs tricky. Let's make sure they haven't crossed somewhere here. What the wild dogs will do, just in terms of their denning, to finish off that question, they're going to choose their den site in the same, using similar criteria that a hyena clan will choose their den sites. I've lost their tracks completely. It's so hard to see here. But they definitely haven't gone north. That is the good thing about this. It's the disadvantage of being rather too short for such vehicles. Okay, let's just double check this junction up ahead and then see whether or not they haven't popped out. Now, unlike the spotted hyena, they are absolutely limited to a litter size of two babies, if that, and usually for young females it is only one. Chitra, the wild dog's puppy litter size can be absolutely enormous. So one of the highest recorded was 21. However, it is not uncommon for wild dogs, females, to regularly be pregnant with youngsters around 18, even 19. The average probably sits at around 13 or so pups. So the wild dog females give birth to way more babies. And that, if you think about it, is a product of the fact that they've got an entire pack to help them care for them. That's the marvelous thing about wild dogs. The truth is that they've got such a low survival rate that despite having that enormous population boost every single year, and the female will breed every single year, despite that, they still don't manage to succeed as a species out here. One of those terribly sad things. And there's stories from when Kruger National Park was started of packs of these hunting dogs. So when Stevenson Hamilton was traveling up through this area, through Leidenberg and up towards the Kruger National Park, he was the first warden of the Kruger. He describes packs and packs, packs of up to 40, 50 individuals moving about. That's something that I only wish we could go back in time and see. Because as mankind, as a species, we have done some serious damage to the wild dogs. And even when the Kruger National Park was started, their idea, totally innocently and entirely well-meaning, their idea of a good conservation strategy was to shoot all the predators. That was how you did conservation. You shot all the predators and then all the general game would come back. And they would describe these fearsome wild dogs that would nothing, you wouldn't see game, game would never come back, it would destroy an area. Totally not true, of course. We understand so much more now. But unfortunately, the damage has been seriously inflicted on their populations. Right, we're going to go back to last tracks because they haven't come along this road. While we do that, let's head back over to Brent and find out how his search is going.
So we've started, we try to outthink the dogs for once, and they've been just that one step ahead of us all morning. So we rushed up towards Sydney's, it sounds like they've gone the other way behind us. Oh dear. So we thought they might be heading towards Sydney's, so we try to jump ahead of where they might be because we could smell them there where we were with Jamie. So if they haven't gone northeast, that means they've gone back west, so... Oh dear. But it is exciting tracking wild dogs. And they are my favorite animal of all the animals we get out here in the bushveld. Just because they're so exciting to track and even more exciting to follow. Copy, thanks. I'm going to do Sandy Patch back towards Impala Plains. Now, still keep an eye on that Juma Dam cam. You've seen how they can change direction so much. And they could literally pop out anywhere. Another good way when you're tracking wild dogs is if you suddenly see Impala flying past you. Well, apparently Jamie's got something completely amazing and I don't even know what it is, so let's go have a look.
Just have a look at this. The waterbuck are all relaxed, but have a look at the female at the back. Now, if you want to see an animal that has had a narrow escape, there is one. I don't know what she escaped from. It could be a leopard, it could be a lion, it could even be those wild dogs. Just look at her. Oh, poor girl. She is absolutely covered. She's soaked around her head with blood. And that, I would say it's unlikely to be wild dogs. It must have been a leopard or a lion. Let's reposition so we don't have the sun shining straight on it and you can get an idea. So if you are slightly, if you are sensitive to the sight of blood, when we do reposition, you might want to turn away. But she's going to be fine, by the way. She's going to be absolutely fine. She's not mortally wounded. It's just a serious... There we go. Just a serious injury. I wonder what she escaped and when that happened. Shame, girl. Let's try one more reposition. Could it be dogs? I don't think so. I'll just tell you why. It's the position of that injury. It looks as though it's on the top of her neck and her ear. But maybe if they manage to pull her head down, it's possible. But I think chances are it was... She looks too relaxed for a start. I think this injury happened last night. She's being very difficult right now. Not, of course, that we blame her at all. She's just not quite in an easy position to see. My suspicion is either... No, girl, it's okay. My suspicion is either lion or leopard, to be honest. That injury. Something jumping on the back of her head. And of course, as you know, head wounds do bleed a great deal, so it might not be as serious as it looks. Her ear's a little bit torn up. Very interesting. No, that's definitely something's jumped on her back and grabbed her by the back of the neck. Can see where the most of the blood is situated, behind the ears there. So that, you are looking at one of the luckiest waterbuck, or she must certainly feel like one of the luckiest waterbuck out here. She's done phenomenally well to have survived. A really, truly fortunate escape. She's big, so the chances are she'd definitely be too big for a female leopard. A male, maybe, of Tingana's size, maybe for Gijima or Mvula in this area. But with all of the lion activity out here, I would say my guess would be lion. I don't think wild dog. She's not injured anywhere else. Might even just be her ear that's a bit torn up. But she looks absolutely fine otherwise. No limps, no other visible wounds. She's probably going to be just fine. Almost looks too pink to be blood, but it is blood. It has to be. There you go. A very fortunate waterbuck. The only thing she has to do now is stave off infection. As you can imagine, the mouth of a predator is not a pretty place. There's plenty of bacteria that lives in there. But with these animals' phenomenal immune systems, if it were a baby, it would have a greater chance of becoming infected. But because she's an adult and with their incredible resistance to bacteria and their incredible strength and resilience, she's going to be fine. Whew, okay. Now, it wasn't quite amazing, but it was really, really interesting. Amazing was perhaps the wrong word that I used, but I was amazed when I came around the corner and saw her. Well, good luck, girl. I don't think it's our wild dogs, though. I think it's a lucky escape from lions. And so, the search for the wild dogs continues. Where shall we go next, everybody? Shall we check Galigopan? After all of that, because although those tracks led away from there, they've now done a loop back towards it. I wonder if we shouldn't head back in that direction. What amazes me about that waterbuck injury is that it's fresh. That blood, and by the way, if you have tuned out because you didn't want to watch, you can look again. We have moved on from our waterbuck. It is a fresh injury, and yet I have not seen one fresh lion track here. I wonder where that happened. Perhaps in Buffel's Hook, a little bit to the north of us. So, the hunt for the wild dogs continues. And apparently, I've just heard an update on the Game Drive channel. Apparently, Brent says there was a report of a male lion walking from Gowrie Gate. So, he might be responsible for that injury. That's just a little bit to the northwest of where we are. Okay. What should we do, everybody? I think Galigopan. My instinct says Galigopan, let's go Galigopan. My instinct actually said Galigopan when we were back at nearly at Galigopan, and we turned around and we went back. And I think we should go there. I think, potentially, if we hadn't been distracted by those harrier hawks, not that that was a bad sighting, it was an incredible sighting, but if we hadn't been distracted by those, I think we might have found the wild dogs. That smell of them on Mvubu Road was so fresh. And as I said at the time, that's the only time that your sense of smell really comes in useful in the bush. One of the only times. Because it's then that you know that what you're tracking is especially fresh. Hello, buffalo. Now, you would not be concerned by wild dogs, would you? Not in the slightest. Hello, gentlemen. Agreed. I don't suppose you've seen wild dogs, have you? Ah, the buffalo bears his secrets well. Just a gentle snort in displeasure. We're not going to linger for too long with our buffalo bulls. Not to say that they are boring, they are wonderfully extraordinary animals. But they're not what we're looking for right now, and if we linger too long, we will regret it. These wild dogs have led us on such a merry dance. Backwards, forwards, different directions. And that's half the fun of a wild dog chase. I did rudely interrupt Brent in order to show you that particular waterbuck that was so fascinating. I think let us head back to him. Let's find out what his plans are from here.
So unfortunately the wild dog tracks have gone to the north. We're still in the area around Sydney's waterhole. I saw the lion tracks coming across from Sibambili. I'm just trying to see where they come out here. So I didn't see any closer to Sydney's. Okay. I'm trying to make sure he came through one of these paths, but I'm not seeing any tracks yet. So fingers crossed he could still be quite close here. This will be the next spot where he might pop out. Oh yeah, I think I see his track. So, if there's no tracks crossing here, it means he could be in these thickets here. Maybe he's the culprit for Jamie's bloody waterbuck. Just want to check, there's two big paths here. Just lots and lots of hyena tracks. So, as I was saying, where the current hyena den is, I heard from the Manuleti guys that it's just behind Sydney's waterhole in the Manuleti. Just gonna keep checking. There's a couple more large game paths that this lion might have crossed on. But we're checking in reverse now, rather than turning around in case I miss something. You get quite good at reversing when you become a safari guide, because as you can see, we reverse with no mirrors. No rear view mirrors. Interesting. Okay, I'm going to check. There's one more spot here. And there are no tracks. Which is good news. So what happens when you get no tracks in an area you think the animal might cross and you head back to the last track? Maybe he's snoozing right here. I have one last look, see if he didn't sneak off this way. Now, the other thing you do as a safari guide, apart from spending a lot of time looking into the bush, you spend a lot of time looking at the ground. Now, There's various different... methods we use to find animals. One is pure, blind, dumb luck, and we just bump into them. More commonly, we'll follow their tracks or listen for alarm calls. That's good. The tracks might cut further to the east, away from our boundary. Now, let's see where he is. He came through on a path just over here. It was this one. Okay, so here are his tracks on this side. I'll show you them now. Back, but I didn't find any tracks right here. Hopefully, as I jump out of the car, a bush will growl at me and then we would have found the lion. Okay. So the tracks come in on this path. So the last track is there, there, and he goes here. No growling bushes just yet. Where did he go from here? That is the question. There. Did he change direction? Sorry, I'll be back with on the vehicle in a second. I just want to make sure he didn't suddenly change direction, because I didn't see any tracks down there. Fascinating. We're going to go back to where we've just been. It is possible that I've missed the track, but it's quite unlikely with a male lion track being the size of my hand. The other thing is I did see some elephant tracks. Maybe the elephants were here after he was and they walked over his tracks and that's why we couldn't see them. Then we're going to have another closer look. So while we try to figure out what's going on here, let's go back to Jamie, who's got one of a male lion's favorite dinners.
I feel as though this particular buffalo bull has faced many lions down in his life and lived to tell the tale. Look at him. He is absolutely ancient. The patching all over his face, the one broken horn, which you can't see at the moment because he's shy. He's giving you the view of his best side because the other side has a broken horn. We see this particular buffalo bull regularly, and just by the way, my excitement about going to Galagopan. He's the only current resident at Galagopan, apart from the guest who was sitting looking out at me from across the deck, so I felt a bit guilty, so we moved back here. No wild dogs to speak of, and no tracks of wild dogs either, so my gut instinct about Galagopan was in fact mistaken. However, we have decided, between Khat and myself, that this particular buffalo bull is now called Rocky, because he's a fighter. He has clearly fought many battles in his life. Ancient and scarred, and by ancient I don't mean in his 20s or his 30s, that's impossible for a buffalo bull. He will be somewhere in his early to mid-teens. And you can just judge that by the amount of damage to his skull. If we were to look closely, we'd probably find his teeth are worn down and starting to wear away. And that's the only real way that you'll be able to judge a buffalo bull's age. But I think Rocky is a good name. Rocky Balboa.
I agree.
Yeah. And we see him all the time, so we will know exactly which buffalo we are referring to. Excuse me, boy, could you turn your head, please, to show us your other side? No? Fair enough. He looks entirely too peaceful to be bothered with that and our nonsense. He's just going to sit there and ruminate. Which, for him, is the equivalent of sleeping The brain waves that the ruminants go through is the equivalent of a human being's deep sleep. That's what he is doing now. He's awake because he's got to be. They can't really afford to be deeply asleep out here in case something decides that they want to eat them, as Brent described. But he's listening, and at the same time his brain is going through that restful state that owls does when we are deeply asleep. Right. I'm positively exhausted and we didn't even see the wild dogs this morning. They've been keeping us guessing. I don't know where to go now. I'm out of ideas. I think the only answer is to go back to the last set of tracks and check around there. I know that Brent has been waylaid. He's now following up on the lion. Phew. We could, as we drive along the road, just encounter them trotting towards us. That's happened more times than I can count. And probably more times than we've actually legitimately found them, if I'm totally honest. It's usually, with a wild dog sighting, you usually look at the direction the tracks are going in and you aim your car in that direction and just kind of hope for the best. And in my experience of wild dog tracking. Okay, which route shall we pick from here? I think we should go back to the last tracks, double check around there, make sure they don't pop out on the cut line. And then it might be time to concede defeat and move on, but I don't like saying that, and I hate the idea of it. Another good, just by the way, from where we were around Gallagher's shortcut with that water buck, something I didn't think about, but I should have, and something Gert mentioned, was the fact that that waterbuck injury might have been hyena as well. We do know that hyena are hunters, they are very efficient hunters, and it would be within their style to try and grab something like that. They're a bit taller than the wild dogs, so to grab her by the ear would be exactly what a hyena might do. So it could also have been hyena that inflicted that injury. Deanna, with that smell of blood around her, your question is, would other predators be attracted to it? Kind of like that story of the drop of blood in the ocean and a shark, the sharks all zoning in, that had me terrified as a child to go swimming in the sea if I had any kind of scratch or anything like that. In hindsight, it might have been slightly exaggerated by popular perception of sharks. Deanna, not really. They certainly would be able to smell the blood. It certainly might make her more of a target, but only if they were already being hunted. And it would only really harm her chances of survival if she was showing signs of weakness as well as smelling like blood. Because then automatically, as all predators do, they would go for the weakest of the group. So it's not that they would... A hyena might come and investigate that. A snuffling hyena might pick up on droplets of blood that she's dripped on the ground, might follow it for a while just to see what it might be up to. But chances are it's not going to put her more at risk than otherwise. And she otherwise...
So unfortunately that male lion did cross. And the reason we didn't see the tracks was actually a flock of guinea fowl had obliterated them. So while we were driving, it was too difficult to see. But as soon as I was on foot, I could see it a bit better. Well, which is unfortunate. Now we're going to start slowly making our way down towards the east. And see what's happening around Cheetah Cutline, Buffalo's Hook Dam, that area. Hoping the wild dogs might pop out again, but it sounds like they're heading straight north. And as you can see, there's a cold front moving in, and And today I'm very happy I added an extra layer to my layers. I've already got multiple layers, but it seems to be getting colder as the morning progresses rather than warmer today. I'm trying to find out where Jamie's working at the moment. Jamie. Jamie, what area are you working at the moment? Aubrey's got their tracks heading north towards Hardicore and Bothersog. Aubrey has tracks of the Machoa heading north in Buffleshook towards Hardicore Camp. Okay, so Jamie's going to head towards where we think Shadow's got to kill. Copy, I'm going to make my way towards Buffleshook Camp. And we're going to head further to the east. But even though we didn't find the wild dogs this morning, wasn't it exciting to be on the hunt? It is quite frantic. Even just looking for them, forget finding them, then it's even more frantic. But there's a strong possibility they might make their way back west on the sunset safari. Now, those pups are obviously getting quite big, and they're to the west. And that's causing these dogs to now have to travel bigger distances to try keep those puppies well fed. But you never know, those dogs could turn around at any second and pop up on the road in front of us, which is what I'm hoping for, really hoping for. And I thought it was quite fitting that we were chasing around wild dogs this morning, because there we go, one of the Birminghams has been found in Torchwood. He's killed the buffalo by himself. He's got a meal there. But as I was saying, it's quite fitting this morning that by pure chance, I've posted a photograph as a wild dog on my Instagram and Facebook this morning. So Finn's wondering, would the wild dogs be scared of the sound of the vehicles? Not at all, Finn. The animals here are very used to the sound of cars, and with the case of wild dogs, they're actually very curious. So even if you find wild dogs that have never seen a car before, they're quite relaxed around the vehicles. And people on foot, strangely enough. And since we're still chatting about wild dogs, Finn's got another question about wild dogs. And is wondering, how much ground could a wild dog cover in a day? Finn, they can cover sort of easy 40, 50, maybe even 60 kilometers in a day. So they have incredible stamina. And even they can keep up a speed of around 60 kilometers an hour. I've seen them do it personally for about 4.5-5 kilometers. So I'm going to head towards Buffleshook where that lioness is denning. Apparently she's there. No one has seen the cubs this morning. I just want to check if anyone is there before we make our way right there. Okay. Well, if I ever get a chance. Everyone's very chatty this morning. Oh dear, you need to get really quick on the radio this morning to just get a chance to speak. Every time I think I've got a chance. Okay. Oh. Okay. Now this is possibly the longest. Is there any station with the Wansatiangala at Buffalo's Hook Dam or to the east of Buffalo's Hook Dam? Copy, thanks. If there's no one else standing by, I'd like to make my way there. Thank you very much. Okay, I'm back after possibly the longest marathon I've heard on the radio in quite some time. It sounds like the cubs have come out and are suckling on mom. So let's go and see if we can get some views of those delectable little monsters. So I know we're going to head off towards those lions. Jamie is not wanting Shadow and Cub to get the better of her. So I know her and Herbie are in that area. So let's see how their tracking is going.
And that is indeed the plan. We are heading back to where Shadow and her cubs' tracks were last seen by Herbert yesterday afternoon. We've been distracted by a magnificent male Inyala, who is crossing the road in what I could only describe as a very stately fashion. These male Inyala are truly beautiful to look at. We have a person in camp who has never seen, or hasn't spent a lot of time in the African bush, and he came out asking us. He'd seen an antelope that was walking very, very slowly, as he described it. And he meant, of course, the male Inyala doing their slow dance that they do whenever they find another male that they feel that they're in competition with. So they fluff themselves up, and they do that very, very slow walk. He's moved off into very thick bush. We're not going to get another view. So join us as we head back towards where Shadow and her cub were last around. The wild dogs may have crossed, but I'm really keeping my fingers crossed that Shadow has not done something similar. But it's okay if she has, because chances are if she has crossed, she might have moved towards Arethusa. And Zola Hayes, welcome to our live safaris. You are a new viewer and are quite certain that this is the best live safari, well, best live, it's the only live safari, the best live YouTube channel you have ever encountered. I am thrilled to hear it. There are multiple platforms upon which you can watch our live safari experience. We're out every day, twice a day, and every single drive brings with it something new and exciting. It is truly marvelous to be out here in the African bush and to be able to broadcast it across the globe. We'd love to hear where you are from. It's just always fascinating to learn about where our different viewers come from and how far our live safari experience reaches. At the moment, we haven't even managed to find you any of the cats or the dogs, but nevertheless, it is the most extraordinary excite, and I love mornings like this. It is so much fun. Even though the dogs crossed, that sense of expectation and excitement and that pounding heart that you get, you can't beat it for feeling alive. I've completely forgotten that it's cold. and that we're in the middle of winter here in the African bush. Because we've been so distracted by the prospect of so many exciting things. Now, don't forget that you can send through your questions, and this is for all of our new viewers. You can send through questions as well. It is an interactive safari experience, so you can imagine that you're on the back of the vehicle with us, and you can do that on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or email through on questions@wildearth.tv. And please do let us know. Let us know if you're a new viewer and you've joined us for the first time. Let us know where you're from. And please feel free, don't get embarrassed about asking anything about what it is you're seeing or what you've heard about life on a safari vehicle. We do really enjoy hearing from you, and it's what makes this experience so real. I always thought before I started working here that I would really miss, I'd struggle with not having guests on the back. And of course, I'm not alone out here. I do have a cameraman, in this case, Gert. But I did think that it was going to be an almost lonely experience. And that's not been what it's been like at all. In the last year that I've been working here, it really truly feels as though we have the largest safari vehicle on earth, with people on the back with us, asking their questions, making their comments, sharing in our inside jokes. It becomes a community and a family rather than just your average live channel. Not that there are, I don't think there's a single live channel out there that can compete with us, but I'm biased. The best use modern technology has ever been put to use with. And again, I'm a little bit biased there. But I wake up every day thrilled that we can bring you this particular way of watching the animals' lives. And that's what's so marvelous about it, is that it's not as though you've come on safari for 2 or 3 days, not that there's anything wrong with that, but you can actually follow the animals, learn them, learn the characters, get to know them by name, to the point that when you see a leopard, you'll know exactly which leopard it is. Or, in fact, not just leopard, but also lion. And we've been remarkably fortunate. We've got some really wonderful moments to look forward to with the Lions of Juma. And speaking of the Lions of Juma and Arethusa and Cheetah Plains, I believe that Brent has arrived at one of them.
Now, we've made our way towards the Nkauma lioness's den. Now, it's not the best view, but the cubs are suckling. Oh, I can see one cub suckling, so I assume the others are. She's currently got her back to us, but she might turn if she gets uncomfortable. Now, can you believe, if you can see her paw to the, there we go, center of screen. Oh, excuse me. Just above her paw, we can see a little spotty thing. Now, that is one of the cubs currently attached to a teat. See all the flies as well. Oh, there we go. Hello, little one. Oh, shaking its head to try to get rid of some of the flies that were biting it. I'm quite sure Mom probably brought most of those flies with her. Oh, that's that. The lions aren't the only things here at the lion den, and just scuffling around in the leaf litter behind me is a pair of crested Franklins. Better watch out for when those cubs get a bit older. They're definitely going to try and chase you, probably very unsuccessfully though. Looking for any insects and grass seeds that might be around. One of the noisiest birds in the bush, often adding to the dawn chorus. Oh, we've got some movement this side. The cubs look like they're, oh, look, climbing up a bit. Could be jostling for position. or could just be tired of suckling now and moving off. Oh, I'm going to get a foot from Mum. Now, if they finish suckling, there could be a bit of playtime between the little ones. Where are you off to, mister? No, I'm going to head back into the huddle. You can see they're still really clumsy. Climbing up to Mom's head. They're just so sweet. Oh, falling through the bushes or the branches around Mom. You can just see them moving. It looks like if we come back, let's go back into my arm. Oh, around her tail there, Dave. There. Let's have a quick look in there. Let's see. There is still one cub. I just saw that little bit of movement. Now, Emily is wondering, what is the purpose of lion cubs having spots? And it is camouflage. Helps them to remain hidden from potential predators. So sweet. That one's obviously still thirsty. Of course, lion cubs are incredibly cute. Now, they are going to be getting mobile soon. And that's when they become even more cute, when you see them rough housing and tumbling on top of each other. Not quite old enough for that yet. My mom's been here for nearly a full day. I mean, she's probably got a nice full tummy. We can't really see from here. I think she'll probably leave them maybe sometime during the day or this evening. Come on, little guys, come out for a play. Now, Pat is wondering whether this lion, if it becomes aware of our current distance, will it become territorial and aggressive with us? Now, Pat, this lion is definitely aware we're here. Their hearing is fantastic. They would have heard us she would have heard us coming from a mile off. And she is completely habituated to vehicles. She's grown up as a cub around vehicles. And you can see she absolutely takes no notice of the vehicle. And she lifted her head to look at what was scurrying around in the under litter, and that was the crested Franklins. So she took more notice of them than of us. So she will not become territorial or aggressive. If you're on foot, it might be a slightly different story. Oh, look there. Straight through the front in the dead tree, you see it? What have we got there? A white-backed vulture catching some morning rays. Now they'll wait for it to get a bit warmer before catching the thermals. Well, Pat's just saying thank you for answering my question. Well, Pat, it is my absolute pleasure. And welcome to Safari Live. Pat's a first-time viewer, and always great to have new viewers. And please keep sending through your questions, Pat. Now, there's a white-backed vulture atop that dead knobthorn. And yesterday, I actually found a buffalo kill that none of us knew about. A young buffalo. So I think that's where this lioness has been feeding. So I saw a couple of vultures around, not too far from here. And I had a little walk, and I found the fact that the lions had managed to, or it looked like just the lioness had managed to finish a whole buffalo without us even knowing she was there. No more than about 500 meters from the den site, so it would have been perfect for her. We got a little bit of cub movement. I think just re-jostling on the nipple. I think we've had about the best view we're going to have of those little ones for now. So I think we'll leave Mama Lioness to keep feeding. We'll just wait a few more minutes. Shamsung's wondering, do we have fleas out here, and can the cubs or young animals become anemic from the bites? We've got lots and lots of fleas, and lions are full of them, as well as a lot of other animals. I've never heard of any of the youngsters becoming anemic from it. I think they have a harder time with the biting flies. But you must remember, these animals are incredibly tough, and predators out here are immune to so many different types of diseases. And if you think about what they eat, lions are quite happy to scavenge five-day-old rotting meat full of maggots. Okay, well, let's leave Mom. Let's head down towards the Buffalo's Hook Dam. And we're going to move towards the dam, leave her be. We'll definitely come back and check on the sunset safari. Hopefully she might have moved out of there a little bit and we can get a better view of her feeding her little cubs. Now, a rhesus fox has a very important question. What is cuter, wild dog puppies or lion cubs? Well, we've already established that lion cubs are definitely cuter than leopard cubs in our esteemed opinion, but now, oof, that's a difficult one for me personally, but I do have a particular fascination with the wild dogs. For me, I would say wild dog puppies are cuter. That's my personal opinion. I'm sure there's a few people who might disagree with me. But that's my personal opinion. So while we make our way towards the Buffalo's Hook waterhole, let's jump back on board with Jamie and see how her leopard tracking is going.
Our leopard's tracking is going marvelously. So Shadow's left the place where she was, and I've just been chatting to the Arethusa guides. They've picked up on her tracks around Red Dam, and we're making our way there to see if we can't help them to follow up. So they've crossed west onto Arethusa. Our Roy is helping us there. And Cedric provided us, Cedric being from Arethusa, he has provided us with a wealth of hugely interesting information. First of all, for those of you who are wondering about the Great Queen Karula, here's our male leopard tracks. Sorry. That's not a female leopard's footprint at all. Not what I was expecting to see. I'll give you that update in a moment. These tracks are male leopard, and I know that just by their size. Oh, hold on. They're the monkeys. Come, never mind. No tracks for you. There's male leopards, female. There's female leopards here. This is interesting. I wonder if Sindile hasn't made his way back towards Mom. Or is it one of our other males? Our station's the Gao alarming just to the southwest of Red Dam. Those monkeys. They're going off because there's a leopard somewhere here. Somewhere in here. Let's see if we can't spot the monkeys that are alarm calling. Bear with me one moment. We're going to stop the vehicle and just listen. I have this horrible, horrible feeling we're going to lose signal. Okay, I'm taking my earpiece out completely. You guys can look at Red Dam. Come. Are we going to lose signal? Yes. There is a very, very good chance that we cannot go in this direction. There's male leopard tracks, there's female leopard tracks. The guys picked up on tracks for cubs as well. This is really interesting situation. It could be that Tingana or the Anderson male have joined up with Shadow. They're both potential fathers of her brand new little cub. And it's not unheard of for a male leopard that is dominant over an area to join up with a female and their cub for a little while. We're going to risk it. We're going to risk the signal because those monkeys are alarming right there. It is through a dip. Please don't go. Please don't go. Please don't go. Please don't go. Come on, signal. We still seem to be okay. Everybody hold on to your seats. Right, where are these monkeys? Better turn my... Hold on, guys, I just need to chat quickly. I think that they've picked up on something here. How's it, guys? How are you?
Good, and yourself?
Good, thank you. That's How's good. It?
We just want to get to the monkey.
Yeah, I can hear them in here.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Cool.
Thanks. We'll see you there. Cheers. I think we should follow him. He knows the roads very well, and he will be able to take us on a journey. We're going to find these leopards. Oh, they're so close. Sorry there, Fat. Those monkeys are just on the other side of the crest, but I do need to concentrate on the game drive channel because what I don't want to do is come barging in and accidentally bump into the sighting if they have already got it. And as you know, game drive channel can get quite busy. So what we're going to do is we're going to send you back over to Brent for now. When I see you again, fingers crossed, we'll have a leopard for you.
So we're slowly meandering down towards the Biffles Hook waterhole. I'm going to try and see if there's anything there. You never know what might be there. I think our hippopotamus friend might not be there today, old Bachelor Bob. Now, the reason I think that is because it's still quite cool and the sun's not really beating down. So he might take the opportunity in this cool weather to spend some time feeding for a bit longer before he has to try and make for the mud. Okay, let's have a look. Now we're about to arrive. And let's see if Bachelor Bob is going to prove me right or wrong. Ha-ha! And you love it when you're right. No sign of Bachelor Bob yet. As I said, I think he's going to take advantage of this cool morning to feed a little bit longer. But we do have some other critters that are quite often resident here at the Biffles Hook waterhole. It's the pair of Egyptian geese walking across the mud flat. Just listening for a second, see if there's any sound. Oh, let's move from those geese there, Dad. On the edge of this little buffalo thorn on the dam wall, there's a little party of birds doing a bit of sunbathing. So let's have a quick look there. Aha! We have two species. Now, for the birders, just to get your grey matter churning. Now, I'm going to ask you what both those species are. They're quite easy ones. I think a lot of our regular birders should get them quite quickly. And here we go. What are those two different bird species perched on the edge of that buffalo thorn? If you know the answer, questions at wildearth.tv or hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Okay, now let's have a quick look. Now, I saw a bird yesterday. It was the first time I've seen it in Juma, and it is an absolutely... Oh, so much dust on here. Let me just give it a quick clean. Absolutely stunning bird. So in our garden, there are some aloes that have started flowering, and they have attracted... So funny, I can hear the Egyptian geese sifting for food in the little bit of mud there. It just says... Can you hear that? You can just hear them as they sift there, picking up little bits of food. It's a very strange sound. What was that? Now, I was talking about the sunbird I saw for the... I've seen them at home quite often, but this is the first time I've seen them at Juma. In our garden... We've got some aloes flowering. So, there we go. Sweat. How's that, Dev? There we go. The scarlet-chested sunbird. They are absolutely stunning, and they are in their full breeding colors at the moment. Let's see if we've got a photograph of them for you. There we go. I mean, isn't that absolutely gorgeous? Now, I'm going to try get a photo of these from my bedroom. Okay, so we're going to keep moving. Jamie's found those monkeys that were shouting atop a tree, so let's go have a look.
Guys, listen to this. Just listen to the sounds of these upset monkeys. Starting to calm down. Go away, birds, cross now. I'm calling up here. We're gonna go a little bit outside of the drainage. I think this leopard has just crossed through here. The monkeys are furious at whatever's Bestel alarm calling. Hold on. Let's just wait here. That is a leopard alarm call. I might not speak monkey perfectly or fluently, but that is a leopard alarm call. They're furious. What's up, guys? Where are they all looking? It's the ones in that jackalberry that are fiercely alarm calling. Have they been hunted? The last time we saw Shadow and her cub, she had a monkey kill. So we know that she is a proficient monkey hunter, and something's got them absolutely furious. I wonder if she hasn't caught one in here. I just want to go check why the go-away birds are calling, or if they're just calling in response to these alarm calls, but these monkeys are fuming. I'm torn. They're looking down and they're not looking this way. Let's just go a bit closer. Let's just wait. Let's keep here. Let's stay here. We're close. We're very, very close to this leopard. Hey, guys. Monkeys. Where's the...
Well, it sounds exciting. If the monkeys are very angry, they're really good at spotting leopards and lions and such. And, oh, that's quite far off. I was hoping he was going to fly towards us. And there's a batalier. Beautiful birds. Incredible eyesight. Often the first bird to spot a kill. Okay, so while Jamie searches for a big cat, I think we're going to look for some smaller stuff. Let's have a look for some birds. Although it's not the greatest birding day, we could always do some trees. Now, the one tree we don't see too often around here is a fig tree. Now, this particular fig tree is very interesting. So if we have a look at that, now if we keep to the left, Dave, and zoom in on those leaves there. The big tree. Right. Yes, there's the big tree. There we go. So that is a leadwood. And if we come out a bit, we can have a look. So a bird has deposited a fig seed in a fork of that leadwood. And this fig tree is slowly killing the leadwood. If we come down to the right, you can see the main stem of the fig. There we go. Zoom in there. Okay, you can see that fig. Now if we move further down, sorry, Herbie's just calling me on the radio, standing by, and you can see how that fig is busy strangling the life out of that leadwood. Nyala Road North. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Copy, thanks. So look at that. So that's a fig tree. That actually looks like a sycamore fig. It's lost all its leaves, so a bit difficult. But we don't have many, many fig trees here on Juma. And this is possibly the biggest one I've seen. And it's busy killing a massive leadwood. That leadwood it's killing is probably 700 years old or so. But it is quite fascinating. I've just heard, we saw Quarantine yesterday on the Sunset Safari. I've just found out he is in Buffalo's Hook. He has probably walked 10 kilometers from where we saw him last night. More actually, probably 15 kilometers. Hi, Mary. Now, Mary's asking a very important question. And often you'll see us driving off-road and over certain tree species. And Mary's wondering, which ones can we drive over and which ones can't we? And what's the difference and why? So there are certain species that are protected. These are mostly slow-growing trees, and we've actually got some right here. Now, this one just off that one there. No, but back this way. That one. Yeah, that one. That is a timbuerti tree. Now, very slow growing hardwoods, and they take a long time to recover if you drive over baby timbuertis. And if we move further down the drainage line, there's a big jackalberry tree or medium sized jackalberry tree. And that is also one of those hard, slow growing trees that we don't drive over. Now, also you'll notice the elephants don't really push down those trees either. Well, they do sometimes, but very, very seldom. Now, the trees we will drive over are generally very, very fast growing and quite springy. So the wood's not too hard, like a magic gwari, which is next to us here. So that one would be even a bit big for us to drive over. It's got a big stump, but normally we drive over them and they spring back up. And a lot of people quite often think we're doing a lot of damage. Now, us driving over a few bushes and trees is nothing compared, even if we just stop in this little spot here and have a look. Now, if we start from here, you can see there's trees that are far too big even for us to drive over, that have been pushed down, manhandled. And if we just keep coming, you can just see all of the dead branches and stuff. And none of that is from a vehicle. Those are all from elephants. And so if you compare us driving off-road to an elephant, even a female elephant weighs more than our vehicles. And they, of course, do a lot more localized work. So, I mean, they will literally plow through an area. And now with the drought, they're actually causing some really nice clearings to happen. And that's quite natural. And what will happen is the next big rains we have, we're going to have more grass. So we've had a very wet sort of 10 years. We're now going into a bit of a dry cycle, and that's not uncommon. A drought of this magnitude isn't that common, but to have a dry cycle after a wet cycle, and it generally works between 8 and 10 years, the wet and dry cycles. And we actually had quite a long wet cycle of about 10, 12 years. We are now in a dry cycle, which will probably last 8 years. I'm not saying it's going to be 8 years of drought. I'm just going to say it's going to be 8 years that were drier than the previous 8 years. And that's the nature's way of controlling certain things. So during this really wet cycle, a lot of the grass species have suffered because the trees have overtaken. And of course, if there's too much tree cover above the grass, it doesn't grow. Now, and that also brings down your numbers of grazers. Buffalo, impala, zebra, wildebeest. So now, with the elephants opening the stuff up, even though quite a lot of those species are going to die during the drought from lack of nutrition, when that really strong genetic stock that's left after the end of the drought is there, and we get good rain, we're going to have a lot more grass coming through. And the elephants will have cleared a lot of the bushes. And a lot of the stuff they're clearing is young. I mean, it's not more than 10 years old. But it's just had such good luck in terms of growing conditions over the last 10 years that it's, in certain areas, completely taken over, like those little monkey orange thickets. Now, with the drought, a combination of the droughts and the elephants, it's going to clear out those thickets, and then we'll have some more grassland type or more open clearings till the next wet cycle, and it'll change again. So each sort of plant species has its day in the sun, so to speak. So we're going to keep heading down towards the south. While we do that, let's go see what Jamie's been up to, trying to find what those monkeys were shouting at.
We are racing back around, so we bumped into Roy, who said that the tracks of the male leopard go into a block. He thinks that perhaps he's killed a dacre. So it's interesting. Remember how I said there were male leopard tracks? There's also female leopard tracks, so Shadow is still around here somewhere. Potentially with her cub, but now we're tracking a male. We don't know which male we're looking for. Ah, it's a marvelously exciting morning. We're going to try and do a loop around and see if we don't bump into him. Those monkeys were furious. They were so cross. Very indignant. And monkeys are some of your best and most reliable alarm callers. They've got sharp eyes, they've got the advantage of height from the tops of trees. The only disadvantage to that is that they continue to alarm call for quite a long time, which doesn't necessarily give you the best indication as to whether or not the animal is still in the area. So what we're doing is we're going back around the road that we were originally on, that we did that very complex U-turn where I nearly knocked Cat off the vehicle. We're going back there. So we're on the other side of Red Dam. Going as quickly as possible, bumping about. You can't go too quickly out here because the bolsters in this particular area, those bumps that we go over in the road, they're not speed bumps. They are for water retention. However, it does mean that they act like speed bumps because they're particularly sharp in this area. So they're to catch water that runs along the road and feed it back off on either side into the surrounding bush. So it's not for speed, it's not for speed purposes. If I knew where I was, life would be marvelous. I can't remember what road, particular road this is called. I think it's called Mafufunyan. But we're about to come to the pump house to the west of Red Dam. I think it's called Mafufunyan. Mafufunyan, by the way, is one of my favorite words in sort of Funagalore. It basically means a little bit crazy. Okay. Right, we've checked this whole drainage system. We bumped into some very excited guests while we were checking this area. Okay, let's go along here. Everybody check very carefully. This is the direction that leopard was heading in. And I have a vague feeling that Roy might be hot on the trail, just because he's called his tracker to go onto the private channel. So he's walking in the block on the other side, and together we're kind of checking every possible outlet for this leopard. Please let it be Anderson, that would be so exciting. Unlikely though, it's probably Tingana. But I've never seen the Anderson male. The Anderson male is dominant to the west of us, and apparently, word on the street is that he's absolutely enormous. One of the biggest leopards in the northern Sabi Sands history. There's a warthog there, but we can't stop. So there's the warthog. Have a look-see. Hello, big boy. You are magnificent. And on any other day, we would stop and stare at you for hours on end, but we don't have time, so we're going to leave you be. Sorry, boy. Sorry, everybody. It's just been one of those frantic mornings. Coming through to Knobthorn Pan. He hasn't popped out here. And I don't think he's going to. If he's caught a dacre in there, if he's caught something, he's going to move it away from the alarm calling monkeys because he doesn't want to draw attention to himself. And then he's going to settle down to feed. Ooh, what an amazing morning. Full of anticipation. Luckily for us, it's not a huge block. Everybody keep your eyes peeled for the flick of a white tail. Obviously, I need some concentration here, and I'm not really focusing too much on you guys, which is not true. I'm trying to find you something amazing. However, I'm going to send you back across to Brent for now. And once again, fingers crossed, when I see you again, it will be with that leopard.
Now, Dangerous Dave, the objectified dish and myself, decided we're going to leave the big cat hunting to Jamie. And we're going to keep moving down the little Mwati River here. And we're going to be looking for birds, bugs, oh, and trees, and tracks. Now, there's quite an interesting track in the road. You see it there, Dave. Now, I wonder, Dave, do you know what that is?
Snake?
No, it's not a snake, but it is indeed a reptile. So, let me see. How's this over here, Dave? So you can see the ground?
Yep.
Okay, so we've got a tail, but we've got footprints on either side of the tail. And if we use that trick to see what the distance is between the footprints, it doesn't work with this animal so well. So theoretically, if we took from the back of the pad to there, this animal should be that big, and it's not. But it's got a very long body. So that's why it's got those big gaps between the tracks. Now, this is a very big one. If I take the track, I mean, it's nearly the same length as my hand. Now, I was going to guess. I'm not actually going to guess because I know what it is. It is a rock monitor. So a monitor lizard and a very big one. So let's see where his tracks go. And now these guys like to nest in hollow trees or sort of little caves on the edge or in rocks. Unlike their cousin, the water monitor, was of course always around water. Now I say this is a rock monitor because we're not very close to any water. We do sometimes have water monitors moving between different patches of water. Okay. Where are you off to, Mr. Rock Monitor? It's still going straight. Maybe we can track it all the way to its nest. Now, we're going to go through the Combretum Arch of the Mulwati River. I'm going to have to go slowly while Dave drops the antenna. The other thing I am hoping to do is find a nice bird party as it's got a bit warmer around this little riverbed. Now, the monitor is still continuing on in the tracks of the there. Oh no, where did he go? Veered off. Which way did he veer off? There we go, well spotted, Dave. That's where he's veered off. He's veered off here, gone towards this jackalberry tree. Now, if we look carefully, I'm looking for any holes in the trees or in the root systems, and we might be able to spot him. Now, being so cold, I was hoping he'd found a hole that he could bask out of, but it doesn't look like it. Looks like he's continued up there, so we're going to continue on our endeavor to find a bird party. While we look for birds, Justin's wondering if we ever seen any birds on the reserve that are not supposed to be here. A couple of times, Justin. And of course, birds don't read the bird books, so they can pop up wherever they want. The one from last year that we saw that's not supposed to be here is the purple banded sunbird. And that's not supposed to be here. And that's, I think, the best of the birds we've got last year. But every now and then, strange things do arrive. Migrants blown off course, not too far from here. There was an Egyptian vulture seen, and it was the first one seen in the Greater Kruger in about 20 years. So it does happen. Look at this, isn't this just an absolutely beautiful big old jackalberry or African ebony tree? Now we've actually seen Karula with a kill in this tree quite a long time ago. Let me just have a quick look. It was a little bush bug. Now, I wonder if we can find any remnants. I'm trying to think. It was probably 5-6 months ago. Sorry, it's just vultures waking up. So let's see. Can I find anything left of Karula's kill? Ha! I can. Little bits of bone fragment and even a little bit of the jaw. Now, look at that. It's almost completely picked clean now. and it wasn't that long ago. So that is a little piece of a bushbuck jaw that Queen Karula munched on. Now, if we have a look, I said it was a young bushbuck. You can see these teeth weren't even out yet. So, not too old a bushbuck. Amazing, isn't it? And you see the stains from the vegetation? Those dark stains there are not mud or anything. That's from the tannins in the leaves that the bushbuck ate. You can still see, still coming out. So still pushing through. So this bushbuck died quite young due to feed Queen Karula. And actually, it was the second or third time the cubs were seen. The cubs must have been a month. So that was 4 months ago. Keep seeing if we can find any other little fascinating things in the Moarkie riverbed. Now there's one of the antelope that really like these little river systems. Not the best view of one, he's hiding behind a timbuti tree. And there we go, a male inyala. Chewing the cud and watching us through the bush. I do love that white chevron between their eyes. Oh, almost a look of utter disdain while I was interrupting his cud chewing. Ah, now I think I can see shining horns of another member of the Traphylagus family. And yes, it is, but it's just also quite well hidden. Oh, and he's having a jog. You're going to come out into the gap? No. Well, maybe, just hang on. No, that's the Inyala and Impala, but come down to the left. And you see the big hole in the ground? Just behind that. There we go. There you go, young male kudu. Now, it's quite windy, which is causing some of the antelope to be a bit nervous, including that kudu. Now, in the wind like this there, hearing is a little bit compromised, and kudu relies very heavily on its hearing. You can see how he's scanning with his ears, those massive radar dishes, picking up all sounds around. And again, like the male Inyala, he also has a very pretty chevron on his nose. Oh, there's another one at the back. Actually, that's quite an interesting photograph through that gap. So if you hear a clickety-click, it's just me snapping a shot. And hopefully he's going to wait. Oh, he did. He didn't run, thank goodness. Normally, as soon as I pick up my camera for a kudu, it's when they decide to move. Nice little view through the sort of portal there. And looks like he's decided we're not a threat. There's quite a few of them coming through. All look like young males so far. There's a slightly older male. You can see his horns are a bit bigger. I love the way they put their horns down their neck as they move through the thickets, as to not get entangled. Now, he's got interest in something else other than the young males, which is about to pop out a little bit to the right. A little bit more. There, behind that bush there. There she comes. A female kudu. Now I wonder if she's an estrus, that male is following her. So as soon as she changed direction, so did he. Of course, those young males, about 2 years old, not quite ready to compete for breeding rights. And it looks like here he comes. You can just see his legs moving through the bush. Now let's see if she's interested in his amorous intention. No, he's going to have a snack. I'm going to try and move a bit forward to get a better view of them. Oh, there we go. She's going to jog out into the riverbed. There we go. They are such beautiful antelope. One of the bigger antelope species we get here. Here comes the male. Hello, big boy. Oh, no, he's not as convinced that we have good intention. He's going to come down a steep section of the bank. This could be quite spectacular. So, everyone ready with the screenshots? Give him a second to have a snack. Now, both the male and... here he comes. Oh, no, he's decided he's going to walk on top. Keep an eye on the female from the high ground. Now, if we look to the female again, which is to our right, she's eating a noxious plant. It's called a timberti tree, and they have a very strong poisonous milky latex. And kudu will eat them, especially now during a time of drought. They will get some nutrients from them, but also it helps purge their system of any intestinal parasites. Just watch the male. Sorry, Dave. I know I'm making you jump around, but it looks like you might come down the bank. Oh, no, he's just stretching out over the bank for a snack. I think he will come down shortly. Hi, Det from Düsseldorf. Oh, here he goes. Dup, 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 dup. Oh, that was very, very elegantly done, mister. Stop in the riverbed for a quick photo. No, you're going to keep moving. Now, those magnificent horns, Det is asking about them and asking, are they part of the skeleton? They are indeed, Det. I'm actually going to show you a buffalo skull that I know about just down the road. It's easier to explain. Inside that dark covering, there is bone. So yes, part of the skeleton. Unlike deer, whose antlers grow every season and fall off. I'll see. I remember there's an old buffalo skull just around here somewhere. Should be in the next sort of 40 meters, unless something's moved it. I doubt, but